to see everybody this morning, and thankful we're here in what feels like the start of the fall morning. Feels pretty good out there, too, so we're thankful the Lord lets us just come together. If you're a guest this morning, we're very excited that you're here. We always want to get to know you better. And so we have a little tear out in our bulletins that you can fill out and just put them in the boxes in the back as you leave this morning. And that'll, I'm sorry? Did I say bulletins? I meant connect card. Y'all see Pastor Dave jump when I say that? Connect card in the back, and you can put them out in the boxes and in the foyer as you leave this morning. Thank you, Pastor Dave. And we just want to get to know you better, so that helps us. And I have a couple of things I want to share this morning. We do have a verse that I want to share, but first I want to read something to you. The verse will be Psalm 139:14. And I want to share that because this just got laid on my heart a couple weeks ago. I really love it, so I hope you guys do too. It says, purpose isn't out there waiting to find you. God already gave it to you. God created you in His image with good works for you to do and spiritual gifts to use. And these gifts aren't for our glory, but for God's glory. They aren't given to us to make ourselves feel better or look better to the world around us. These gifts are given to us so that we can reveal God to the world by humbly using them to serve others around us. And the verse from Psalm 139:14, you guys will be, you'll know it. It says, I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works. My soul knows it very well. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. God, thank you so much for today. And thank you for every day you give us. And that the opportunities you give us, Lord, to show others who you are and how much you love us. Thank you, Lord, for giving us a chance to come together and worship you in these times, Lord, because we know that you are in control. Lord, show us your love this morning. Show us your word through Pastor Dave and his message. Make us bold, Lord, to go out and use the gifts you've given us to reach those around us. We pray this in your precious Son's name. Amen.
Good morning. Let's stand and sing Just a Closer Walk with Thee.
worship with us here at Red Mountain Baptist Church on this little bit of a cloudy day, but we are thankful that even though it's cloudy outside, we have joy on the inside because we have Jesus here in our midst. And we're excited that we've gathered for worship. We're glad you're here. As we spend this time in prayer together, let me just share a few things with you. First off, we want to praise the Lord for another wedding anniversary to celebrate. We want to say congratulations to Barry and Nancy Schuler celebrating 39 years of marriage yesterday. Let's praise the Lord for them. It's always a joy of ours to share wedding anniversaries in a society where marriage is throwaway. God says marriage is lifetime, and so we are thankful we can celebrate another couple celebrating a wedding anniversary. Praise God for that. Let me share a couple requests with you, or several requests with you. First off, you've probably seen the email about Dwayne Taylor. What happened to Dwayne this week? In case you didn't know, Dwayne was at work, and he got hit in the eye. This is the same eye that previously he had a cornea transplant on, and his cornea was damaged, his lens was damaged. This was on Thursday. He did go for surgery Thursday night. The surgery did go well, praise the Lord for that. They were able to repair the cornea and put a new lens in. And praise the Lord, his retina was still attached. It was a little cloudy, but Friday morning when he woke up, he was able to see something. Because Thursday, he couldn't see at all after this injury. And so the doctor is very optimistic that his sight will improve. So thank you for praying for that. He will have a couple more surgeries coming up in the future, but do continue praying for Dwayne. And they are so appreciative of all your prayers as God is working in his life. And if you also would pray for Robin Pendergraf, Robin's been having some shortness of breath, and he went in for a nuclear stress test on Friday. They were not able to complete the test, and so he'll go back this Friday to complete the test. So just pray they can figure out what's going on with Robin. He's been resting up this weekend, so remember him and Tammy, the family, in your prayers. And then I've actually been praying, asked to be praying for our schools, our teachers and staff. We're already back at work. Tomorrow our students start. And we know it's going to be crazy for the first several weeks, I'm sure. So we attended open house for our kids at RCS this week, one online, two in person. And I know some schools are doing everything online, some are the hybrid method. So teachers have got a lot on them, and the staff does as well. So we'll be praying for our teachers and staff, we'll be praying for our students. Parents as well. Parents have had to make an adjustment. Our college students also. And so we just remember all those in our school systems and just pray that God would work in a mighty way and God would protect them from any type of outbreak. But just that God would sustain them and give them strength to meet. But also God would use this for our Christian teachers and students to be a witness to those who are looking for hope as they're looking for hope in this time of this pandemic. And that being said, we're going to continue praying for this pandemic. Praise the Lord. Looks like our numbers are decreasing in North Carolina, and we praise the Lord for that. And just want to pray they continue going down. And remember that God is sovereign, God's in control, and God is working through the midst of this pandemic. It's exciting to see how people are coming to know Jesus Christ, the Lord and Savior. People who are scared, people who are without hope are finding peace and hope in Jesus Christ. So be praying that continues to happen. And let's continue praying for our nation. A nation that is in much unrest. As we get closer to the election, I'm sure it's going to just increase. But as I've said multiple times, Pastor Cameron has said, the answer is Jesus. And not even the Sunday school answer, but that is the real answer. It's not going to come because if so-and-so win an election. It's not going to come because Congress passes a law or because demands are met. Peace comes, rest comes, because you know Jesus Christ is Lord and Savior. So we pray that we as Christians will rise up. As Jesus said, the fields are wider to harvest. They're still wider to harvest after 2,000 years ago, him saying that. And so we just want to pray that we as Christians will rise up and share the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ, that they can find peace from the Prince of Peace. And also, let's be praying for our election. Let me encourage you, if you're not registered to vote, go ahead and get registered to vote. If you're worried about standing in long lines, go ahead and order your absentee ballot. You can fill out a form, and they can send you an absentee ballot. This is different than just getting a ballot in the mail. So absentee ballot is legit, everything like that. So I do want to encourage you to do that. But let me encourage you, vote biblically. As a Christian, one day we have to stand before God and give an account of our life. And one of the things we have to give an account for is how we vote. So I want to encourage you, I'm not going to tell you who to vote for, but you take each candidate, whether it's a presidential, vice president, governor, whatever it is, and you line up against God's word, and you vote for the one that best lines up with God's word. Nobody's going to line up perfectly, I'll tell you that. But you vote biblically, because we have to stand before God when they give an account for the way we vote in this election. And so I would encourage you to vote biblically. And vote on the Word of God. Don't vote for what your opinion is. Don't vote for how it's going to affect you financially. Because God's will is going to be done. We pray God's will be done in this election. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Gracious Father, we just thank you for the joy and privilege of this coming to your house to worship together as the body of Christ. Because that's the sole purpose of us being here. And Father, I thank you that we have the freedom to be here today. And I thank you for that we don't have to fight to be here today. I know in California, John MacArthur's church just won a lawsuit because there was threat of even arresting him and fining him and throwing him in prison because his church was open. But Father, we thank you that that lawsuit is won and they can meet in freedom and not be worried about being arrested today in California. And Father, I'm thankful that we've enjoyed that freedom for over 2.5 months now. That we open back up, you've kept us safe from COVID-19. We have not seen any breakouts here. You've kept us safe. And just the joy of just coming together and just worshiping together is something we should not take for granted. And Father, I understand some people are not comfortable coming back yet. That's perfectly okay. There's no judgment from our part. Father, we just pray they just feel part of the body as they worship at home. Maybe they're watching on a DVD or maybe they're going to watch online when it goes online or whatever it is. But we're thankful for the body of Christ that's able to be here today and even those at home. And the body of Christ universal that's around this world that is worshiping you as one, Father. And we just pray that you're honored and glorified, Lord. Father, we thank you for answering prayer requests. We thank you for celebrations of the wedding anniversary. We thank you for just being with Barry and Nancy all these years and they can just give testimony of how good you are to them. We live in a society where marriage is throwaway. If people get in an argument, they say, well, let's just get a divorce and let's just move on to someone else. But Father, we've seen time and time again with couples in this church that when Christ is the center, marriage works. And Father, I just thank you for another example we can celebrate. Father, thank you for answering prayer in Dwayne's life. We thank you that the surgery did go well in his eye on Thursday evening. And that he could even see some on Friday morning. We just pray that our vision continues to improve as the retina becomes less cloudy. And Father, we just pray you heal his eye, Father. And as these other surgeries come along, that you would work in the midst of that, Father. And just continue to restore sight and bring healing to his eye, Lord. Father, we pray for Robin Pendergraft as he's been having shortness of breath and is having some tests done. We just pray you just give the doctor's wisdom and guidance to figure out what's causing this shortness of breath, Father, that he's able to do and complete the nuclear stress test this Friday is where last week he couldn't even complete it. So, Lord, I just pray you give him and Tammy a sense of peace that you're watching over him and you're going to take care of him. Give him the rest he needs, Father, as he's been resting up this weekend. And Lord, I just pray that you just would enable that test to happen this Friday. The doctors can figure out what's going on so they can best treat them. Father, I just want to lift up our teachers to you, Father. I know we have teachers here with us this morning. We have teachers that will be in the 11 o'clock service. We have students and parents of students, Father. And we are thankful that school is starting back up. And yes, it's going to be different. Yes, it's going to be chaotic. This new normal that everybody keeps talking about, Father. But Father, we just pray that you sustain our teachers and the staff and our students and the parents, Father. Lord, we know it's going to be tiring at times, especially on the teachers and staff, because they have to do more and do longer hours. And it seems to be tiring on our parents and students, Father, because things are different at home. And so, Lord, we just pray you give the rest they need at night, give them the strength they need throughout the day, sustain them each and every day, Father. Protect them from any type of outbreak of COVID, Father. And Father, we just pray that as numbers continue to go down, that schools are able to open back up even more so and go in person, Father, for those that can't go in person right now, Lord. And Father, we just pray for this pandemic we're in. We thank you that you're using it to bring people to you seeking salvation and use it for your glory. We thank you that you're bigger than it, Father. You're sovereign. You're in control. And Father, you have a plan why you allow this to happen, and we trust you, Lord. So I just pray, Lord, just trust you that you're working in the midst of it, Lord, that you just will be glorified, that we'll be witnesses for you to those that are looking for hope, those that are looking for strength, Father. And Father, we just pray for our nation that is in turmoil, Lord. And we know that a lot of it is because of political views and things like that, and I believe it's just going to heat up even more so as we get closer to the election in November. But Father, we know that rest and peace will not come because of an election, because of demands being met, because of all that has passed, or whatever else. True rest, true peace comes from you, Jesus. So I pray that we, your people, will rise up and share the good news of Jesus Christ to a nation, to a world that so desperately is searching for. And they don't even know they're searching for it, Father. But that's exactly what they're searching for. We have the answer. His name is Jesus. Lord, give us eyes to see the need that's before us. And we pray for those. We may not agree with them politically. We may not agree with their actions or what they say. But Jesus, you died for them just like you died for us. So Lord, I pray that you use us to share the love of Jesus Christ with all those around us, Father. And Father, we do pray for the election, Lord. I pray that we as Christians will register to vote. If we're not, Father, that we will vote biblically. That we won't vote by what's popular opinion. We vote by what our opinion is or what's going to be good for our finances or this or that or whatever. But we will take each candidate and line them up against your word and see who best lines up with your word, Father. And that's how we'll vote. We'll vote biblically. Because one day we do have to give an account for the way we live our lives as Christians. And we will have to give an account for the way we vote, Father. And I pray by His honor and glory to you, that I pray that your will be done in this election. We ask this in your holy and precious name, Lord God. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Sheila. What a wonderful truth to remind us of. Aren't you thankful? As a Christian, you're never alone. I know I am. If you would take your Bibles and turn to Psalms 23, as you know by now, we're working our way through this very familiar psalm and just taking our time working through it. I hope you've enjoyed it as I have, as it's been very eye-opening and encouraging to me. We're in verse 5 again this Sunday, as we were last Sunday, just taking our time working through it. It was a bright June morning in 1872 when a young mother and wife, the Lamb of Annie Hawks, became filled with a sense of the nearness of the presence of the Lord. Just what Sheila was saying about. She didn't feel alone. And she enjoyed so much this special sense of His presence that she began to think, how could anybody live their life without knowing the Lord Jesus Christ as the Lord and Savior? And so she just enjoyed the presence that she was experiencing and just that deeper sense of His presence. And all of a sudden, the phrase, I need Thee every hour, came rushing to her mind. And you know where I'm going with this. And it was through that experience, it was through that phrase that came rushing to her mind, experiencing the presence of the Lord in a deeper way, that she wrote that song that we sometimes sing, I need Thee every hour. Listen to the chorus of that song. I need Thee, oh I need Thee, every hour I need Thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior, I come to Thee. I don't know about you, but I could echo Annie Hawks' thoughts. I need the Lord every hour. I need the Lord every second. Not just every hour, but every second. You know, as we looked into the 21st Psalm, we're learning how we can face the days that are ahead of us. Let's just be honest. The days that we're in, the days that are coming ahead of us, are uncertain times. That's a word we hear, you know, unprecedented, uncertain times. But you know what? God is sovereign. God is in control. And through Psalms 23, we've been learning how we can deal with the days in which we're in, how we can deal with the days that are ahead of us. Excuse me. And like Annie Hawks, who wrote that song, I don't know how anyone can face the life we're living, the days that we're in, without the Lord Jesus Christ in their life. You know, as for me, I wouldn't want to face life without the Lord. It's just too tough. I'll be honest with you. When I look back over my life, I think about the uncertainty that's ahead. I don't want to do it by myself. I want the Lord with me. And that's why I'm able to say, like with David, the Lord is my shepherd. That personal relationship that David had. It makes all the difference in the world we face like the days we're in. Here in the 21st Psalm, it not only reminds us that we need the Lord, but it also reminds us the Lord is all we need, isn't He? He's all we need for the days that are ahead of us. Once David, he kind of declared what the psalm was about, and we looked at this back at the beginning of the series. It's about the Lord, and once he declared what the psalm was about, David begins to describe what the Lord means to him and what the Lord has meant to him as his personal shepherd. And all through the psalms, David has drawn a picture after picture, analogy after analogy to us, of what the Lord, his shepherd, has meant to us. Let's just kind of quickly review some of the stuff. David spoke of the Lord as one who fills his life with such happiness and such contentment that he could say, I shall not want. He speaks of how the Lord has led him through his life, and he's led him into green pastures. He's led him beside those still waters. He's led him down a path of righteousness. He's described how the Lord has both provided for him and protected him in the experiences of everyday life. So in short, David is saying, how can you face all the days of your life? Well, the answer is, with Jesus. That's how. With the Lord. He's all we need is the Lord. Yes, as I listen to David's testimony, I not only find him declaring the Lord what he's meant to him and describing that he's all he needs, but in Psalms 23, we not only see David's testimony and his feelings about the Lord, but we also see the testimony of the Lord and his feelings for us, his people. Why does the Lord lead us? Why does the Lord feed us? Why does the Lord meet our every need? It's because of how he feels towards us. So this morning, I want you to remember something. As you see on the screen, I want you to remember we are the shepherd's sheep. Cameron, you know, had no idea what I was preaching on. Sheila had no idea what I was preaching on. But I just love how God brings it all together. The verse he shared. God has wonderfully made us for his unique purpose. We are his sheep. He is with us. We are not alone. You know, all through this psalm, I see how the Lord feels about us, his sheep. If you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you can turn away from your sins, you place your faith and trust in Him, you are His sheep. He is our shepherd. And we see how He feels about us, but especially we see this when we get to the phrase we're going to focus in on today in verse 5. You anoint my head with oil. So stand with me in honor of reading God's holy word if you're physically able. Let's see what the Word of God has to say to us this morning.
says, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me to paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies." And then this is where we came out today. "You anoint my head with oil." Father, we thank you for how you care for us. We thank you that we place our faith and trust in your Son, Jesus Christ. We ask forgiveness for our sins. We give our life to him, that we become your sheep and you become our shepherd. I pray we remember that this morning, that we are your sheep. And what that means, oftentimes we forget that. We forget what that means. That we belong to you, that we are part of the family of God. So I pray you use this phrase here in this passage of Scripture this morning in verse 5 to speak to our hearts, to help us remember what that means to be your sheep. Use it to challenge us. Use it to encourage us to live that ultimate purpose you have for us, Father, to bring honor and glory to you. And I ask Holy Spirit to speak to our hearts and empower me to preach your word. We ask this in your name, Jesus. Amen. Thank you. May be seated. You know, the actions taken by the shepherd that are describing these words, to see how deep the Lord's feelings are for us, what he thinks of us, how he cares for us, and how he cares for the sheep of his pasture. They describe the actions of a very personal relationship, an intimate relationship, and they reveal his feelings that he has, not just for the whole flock, but think about this, for each and every single one of us individually. In the very beginning, David spoke of his relationship with the Lord as a personal relationship. That is so key. He says the Lord is my shepherd. We spent some time camping out there as we began the series, and it's that personal connection. You see, you are not a sheep of the shepherd until you first place your faith and trust in Jesus Christ, and he forgives you your sins, and he gives you that gift of everlasting life. And yet, we also see the Lord's relationship with us is very personal when he is our shepherd. It's more than just a relationship with the flock. It's an individual, intimate relationship. And sometimes we forget that. Sometimes we think we just blend into the crowd and the Lord doesn't take notice of us. Hear me this. The Lord takes notice of you. And that's what we're going to see this morning. Because you are his sheep. So as we look at that phrase, "You know my head with oil," there's several things I want us to think about as we remember that we are his sheep. First off, know this. The shepherd knows his sheep. He knows us. The scene behind what's happening here, we're kind of seeing the day in the life of a sheep, if you will, in different seasons. We've talked about that. But it's getting towards the end of the day, and the shepherd is bringing the sheep back to that sheepfold. Now, the sheepfold, as you know, is where the sheep, it's the enclosure where the sheep stay at nighttime. Now, it's different than, you think about a cowboy. A cowboy, you know, when he brings the cows home, it's just the big herd coming back into the crowd. But a shepherd does it differently when he brings his sheep back in the sheepfold at night. He does it not as a big herd, but he does it one by one. It's a scene that reminds us that the Lord is very acquainted with each and every single one of us, that each and every single one of us matter to him. It's not that he's looking at the big flock and saying, "Okay, I love you," because he does. But he's saying to us individually, "I love you and I care about you and I know you intimately." That's the type of connection we're looking at here. You know, in a previous study, when we thought about the shepherd restoring his sheep, I made mention of the shepherd's rod. We talked about that previously in one of the messages. As we saw, that rod had kind of a dual purpose. It was used by the shepherd to protect his sheep, but also it was used by the shepherd at times as an instrument of dealing with those sheep that were disobedient, that were stubborn. And he used it as discipline, actually. But it was also used for something else that I didn't share then that we're going to talk about today. It was used for numbering the sheep, for counting the sheep. Listen to what it says back in Leviticus 27:32. It says, "And concerning the tithe of the herd of the flock, of whatever passes under the rod, the tenth one shall be holy to the Lord." You say, "Well, what's that talking about?" The sheep are spoken of, they are passing under the rod. Well, what is meant by the sheep passing the rod? Well, get the picture. It's eating. The shepherds brought the sheep back to the sheepfold. And when they go in the gate, if you will, he doesn't just push them all at one time. They come in one by one, and what he's doing, he's holding that rod above them, and he's counting them one by one. So that way, you know, as they come in, it's called numbering the sheep, or passing under the rod is what it was known as. So let's just say a shepherd had 100 sheep, and as he counts them, as they come in, he's holding that rod and counting them, but then he only has 99. So what does he do? He goes and looks for the one that is lost. He goes and looks for that 100 sheep that is missing. If he only had 99, but he's got 100 sheep, because he's been able to count how many have come back in the sheepfold. It's a picture of what Jesus was talking about in Luke chapter 15. It gives us that wonderful picture of the shepherd going out in the wilderness to find that one lost sheep. He kept searching for that one lost sheep until he found it. How did the shepherd know that one of his sheep was missing? Because they would pass under the rod. He would count them. He was very acquainted with them. Listen to what a couple of Bible commentators say. R.L. Moyer wrote this. He said, "The flock was one. There was no distinction that severed them. But beneath the rod, the shepherd never lost sight of the individual sheep. He saw each sheep alone." Horace Bushnell said this, "The Lord is not the keeper of the hive of bees, knowing well the hive but not knowing the individual bees, but is the keeper of a flock of sheep, knowing well the flock but also knowing each particular sheep." That shepherd was very familiar with every single individual sheep that he had in the flock. The shepherd was familiar with them. In many cases, he had a special name for them or a nickname. Now, it's not like the common names like we think of, like Fred or Susie or something like that. But rather, the names, you know, they had some bearing on the history of that sheep. So you might hear a shepherd at night, he's bringing the sheep back to the sheepfold, and he's counting them as they come in, and he might say something like that, well, hi there, one born and a driver for a bit. Or he said, oh, there's my lamb from which I traded 2 pots of honey. Or there you are, the one that a bear tried to steal away from me. They had a very unique name. He was very familiar with the history of each sheep. It kind of goes along with the picture of what was talked about in John chapter 10, verse 3, where we read this. The sheep hear his voice, and he calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. Of course, that's talking about Jesus and us being sheep to him, being our shepherd. Philip Keller writes this. He said, "The relationship between the shepherd and the sheep, between Christ and those whom he calls, is one of a personal, profound knowing. For he knows me intimately. He knows me by my name." This scene of the sheep being brought in the sheepfold reminds us that the Lord is personally acquainted with each and every single one of us, with each and every single one of his children. If you are saved, you are a member of a larger family. You are part of the family of God. Or to stay in our picture of what we're thinking about, you're a sheep among a larger flock. Over the book of Revelation, Revelation chapter 7, John describes a picture of what's going to take place of a heavenly host that's so large and so big, they're clothed in white, they have palm branches in their hands, and they're made of all the nations and tribes and people of the world. And John described this host is so large that he says no man can number that host. Well, who is that heavenly host? It's every single person throughout all of history that has ever been saved by the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's you, it's me, you know, Jesus Christ, Lord and Savior. We belong to a spiritual family, to a flock that is made up of people of every race, of every nation, and that multitude is so large, no man can number it. But I remind you that God knows every single one of his children. You're not just a number in a database. You know, when I got saved years ago as a child, God didn't just put me in the heavenly database and convert me to a number of 175-46-38-910, you know, whatever. I'm not just a number on a piece of paper to God. To God, we are more than just a huge flock. We are individuals who are known individually by God. That's how much he loves us. That's how much he cares for us. And he calls each of us by name. He is personally acquainted with each and every single one of us. And he knows us by name. Let those words sink in. What that means to us. To know, and we're going to talk about this moment, that God knows everything about you. God knows what you would face this week. Maybe it was a great week, maybe it's a terrible week, but God knows. God knows what you're going to face this coming week. He knows everything about you. He knows what you're going through. How about you? That encourages my heart. Because right along with what she was saying, I'm never alone. God knows what's going on in my life, and he's right there with me. It challenges me, too, to know that I should live the way I should live. But you've got to know him to be his sheep. Do you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? That's the key. Now that brings us to the second thing we see happen here. Notice the shepherd cares for his sheep. Not only does he know his sheep, but he cares for his sheep. Look what David said. Let's dive into this phrase. It says, "You anoint my head with oil." As the sheep would enter that sheepfold one by one, remember, not only did he count those sheep, but he called them by name, but he also took time to examine the sheep, to see what they had been through in that day, to see if they maybe had some briars that were stuck to their ears, that had some snags in their cheek when they went by a thorn bush. to see if there's any wounds on their side, to see if they had any bruises on their knees, to see if their eyes were inflamed with dust or even the sunshine of the day, to see if they were weary, to see if they were sick. He was checking the condition of each individual sheep because he cared about each individual sheep. You see, during the day, there are many ways that a sheep can get hurt, that they can get wounded, that they can become sick. They can pick up briars, they can get scratched, they can get bruised, they can fall in a hole, they can become weary or ill, whatever. You see, in our journey of life, you think about it, there's many ways in which we get hurt, don't we? It could be physical being hurt, it could be emotional, it could even be spiritual, that we're being attacked spiritually. There's briars of life, there's thorns of life that will wound us, that will scratch us, that will hurt us. Life has many ways of bruising us, of wounding us, doesn't it? And sometimes life itself will leave us weary in the heart, will leave us feeling weak and sick. Does the shepherd ignore those hurts? Does the shepherd pay no attention to the scratches? Does he pay no attention to those wounds, those hurts? Absolutely not. There's not a day that goes by that he does not pay attention. He pays attention to every single sheep and what they've been through in the day. He pays attention to their hurts, to their pains that they've incurred throughout the day. Think about this. Our Lord Jesus Christ is no different. He's even better than that shepherd. Our hurts don't go unnoticed by him. You may think that, you know, what I'm going through, nobody knows what it's like. Nobody knows what I'm experiencing. It may be true. No human does, but Jesus knows. Because Jesus knows you so intimately. He's aware each time your heart is broken. He knows every pain that you bear. He knows every burden that is fully resting upon you. You just feel like you just can't take it anymore. Jesus knows what you're going through. He not only knows us, he knows everything about us. He knows every hurt we face. Everything that just breaks our heart. Sheila sang about him knowing our hurts. That we're never alone. Aren't you thankful for that? I am. If the shepherd found that one of his sheep had been wounded, that one of his sheep had been hurt in the day, he would attend to that wound. He wouldn't have said, oh, tough luck, you're on your own. No, he would attend to that wound. The shepherd would always carry this bottle of oil with him. And when he found that one of his sheep had a scratch, you know what he would do? He'd pour that oil on that scratch. When he found that sheep had a wound, he would take that oil and pour it in that wound, and he'd rub it in that wound. When the sheep had suffered from heat exhaustion, and it was just weary, he'd take that oil, pour his head, and massage his head. You see, that oil had medicinal qualities in it. And it would speed up healing, but also it would prevent infection. So when David spoke of the Lord anointing his head with oil, he was speaking of how the Lord was attending to his hurts and applying the oil to his life to bring healing to his life. The Lord knows our hurts. But not does he know, he does something about it. He applies the oil of heaven to our wounds. Many have experienced the hurts and wounds and bruises of life and have found the Lord supplies what we need, that healing oil to our hurts. Just as the shepherd daily attended the hurts of the sheep, the Lord daily attends to our hurts. His oil brings healing to the brokenhearted. His oil gives grace to us in our time of need. His oil soothes the troubled heart. His oil eases that pain that we feel. His oil gives us strength for the next day when we get home. And I think about some of our teachers or even students this week as they start back to school with, you know, and they just don't want to go back the next day because it's so crazy. God's oil is going to give you strength to go back the next day. He's going to give you what you need. Years ago, I read a story about a lady by the name of Helen Kim, and she described how all her life she had lived a big sheltered life, a very pampered life with her family. She was the youngest of five children. She never really knew what it was like to be alone. I guess not when you have, you know, four siblings, you know, that you're never alone. Her families always did things together. In spring, they would plant the garden together. In the fall, they'd harvest the garden together. They would can those vegetables. They worked together. They played together. At nighttime, they would sing together. They were always together. She was never alone. But then that day came. As people got older, she felt herself alone. Her parents died first. And then her brother died. Then within a month, two of her sisters died unexpectedly. And then finally, her last sister died. And one of the things that she dreaded was going back to that family house alone that was now hers. She didn't have a key to that house because there was always somebody there to let her in. And she didn't want to go home alone. Well, one of her nieces stayed with her for a couple weeks, but the day came when her niece had to go back to her life. So she took her niece to the train station, and then she went back to that house. and she dreaded it. She pulled her car in the garage. She sat there for a while in that car, working the courage just to get out of the car and take those couple steps up into the house. And as she walked up those steps, she cried out to God, "Oh God, help me." And as soon as she walked in the house, she went over, she turned on the radio because she just wanted some noise in the house. She didn't want to have dead silence. And as she was taking off her coat and putting it in the coat closet, she caught wind of what the radio was broadcasting. And here's some lyrics of the song. "No, never alone, no, never alone. He promised never to leave me, never to leave me alone." It was the old-fashioned Revival Hour quartet, but it was more than just a quartet singing a song on the radio. It was God's voice speaking to her through that song, letting her know that she's never alone. And standing there, she realized that from now on, she would never be alone. Let me put it another way. The Lord anointed her hurt with his oil that day. The Lord has oil for your hurts, for your pain, for your sorrows. You're his child. He knows what you're going through. And he knows just what you need. And when David, you can say that when you're hurting, "You anoint my head with oil." He cares for you. Why don't you cry out and say, "God, I just like she did, God, I just can't do this anymore. God, I need your help. God, help me." So her simple prayer was, "God, help me." You ever got to that point where all you can say is, "God, help me, I have." And he supplies what you need with this healing oil. Why? Because he cares for you. Look for his care. Sometimes we get so wrapped up in our hurts. Sometimes we get so wrapped up in our pain. We get so wrapped up in ourselves. We don't even look and see how God is caring. We need to open our eyes and see that he cares. What do these actions of the shepherd say to us? Well, that's the third thing I want you to see. The shepherd loves his sheep. Know that the shepherd loves his sheep. Why does he do all this? Because he loves you. That's why. Look at the shepherd. Every evening, he's causing his sheep to pass underneath that rod. We hear the shepherd, he calls each sheep by name. And we see him examine each of those sheep, and he applies oils to those that are wounded, to those that are hurting. There's not one sheep in that flock that is not important to that shepherd. Every single sheep matters. There's not one sheep in which he does not have great interest. They're all important to him, down to the very last one. There may be some who feel in the body of Christ that they're just, "Well, I'm just a member of the family." They may be thinking things like this, "Well, you know, I'm not special. I'm not unique." Maybe you feel like you're the least in the family. There's other sheep there. You think there's other sheep that are more important to you. Yes, you're his child, but it's like you're the red-headed stepchild, the black sheep of the family, if you will, to use those cliches. You may think God has no particular reason to have any real interest in you, that you're just a number to God. Well, one, I go back to what Pastor Cameron shared at the beginning of service, that you matter to God, and he created you the way he wanted you. But let me put it this way. If I can put it this way. Each day of your life, you pass underneath God's rod. You are so important to God. Yes, he has a tremendous flock, but every sheep matters to him. You are individually special to God. There's no other sheep that's more important. Each sheep is important to God. He cares as much about you as he does about any other member of the family of God. You're not just a member of the family. He knows you. And he knows you by name. And he's deeply interested in you. He's as interested in you as he is in any other sheep. So don't believe that lie of Satan that you don't matter to God, because you matter to God. Each sheep was special to the shepherd. Each sheep was loved by the shepherd. He knew his sheep. He cared for his sheep. He loved his sheep. He loved one as much as he loved the other. And I remind you, the Lord loves you as much as he loves anyone else. And he proved his love for you on Calvary's cross. That's how much God loves you. There was a song that came out several years ago that says it best. "He loves me like I was his only child." That's how much God loves you. Yes, he's got many children. He's got a large family, but he loves you like you're his only child. He loves every single one of you just the same. You are important to God. Just as each sheep was special to the heart of that shepherd, you're special to the heart of God. How can we face the days ahead of us, the uncertain days ahead of us? Because we have a shepherd who treats us like we're the only sheep in his pasture. He loves us. He cares for us. He knows us. Remember who you are as a child of God. Don't believe the lie of the enemy that you don't matter. Don't believe the lie that you're insignificant. Don't believe the lie that you can't do nothing, that you're nobody. Because you, if you know Jesus Christ, you are a child of God. You're a son, you're a daughter of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. God knows you. God cares for you. God loves you. That's the help. That's the encouragement we need to face the uncertain days that are ahead of us. So what is it you're struggling with this morning, Christian? God knows. But maybe He's waiting for you to say, God help me. You just cry out to Him, God help me. Every Sunday morning I get up and I don't do this as routine. I do it because I really mean it. God, I can't do this. I need you to do it through me. I don't ever want to be Dave Pryor here preaching. I want to be God preaching through me. Because I need Him to do it. This morning I woke up at 3 o'clock. I don't know why I just did. Couldn't get back to sleep. I set my alarm for a little bit after 5. I get up and study the message a couple more times. 3 o'clock I woke up. Do you know what I do now when I wake up early and can't get back to sleep? I start praying. And I don't know what it is about this morning, but I just need to spend some more time in prayer. To show my utter dependence upon Him to do what He's called me to do. He's there to help us. He's there to strengthen us because He loves us, because He cares for us, because He knows us. And we've got to recognize how much we need Him. And that's where we are, Christians. We've got to cry out to Him. Lord, help me. And remember, you're not a sheep of the shepherd until you first met Jesus Christ, Lord and Savior. So maybe that's where you are today, is you've got to place your faith and trust in Him. You've got to repent of your sins and believe in who Jesus is and what He did for you on Calvary's cross, how He died for your sins. He took that punishment and He was buried and rose again the third day. And you ask Him to forgive you and save you and give your life to Him. And you see that gift of everlasting life. And then you become His sheep and He becomes your shepherd. Maybe that's where you are today. I want to encourage you to do that today. Father, I thank You for this song. Psalm 23, a song that so many of us probably have memorized. And sad to say, too many Christians recited at a funeral, recited at a bedside, recited wherever. And we really don't think about what it means. But Jesus, I'm thankful that You're a shepherd who anoints our head with oil. That You show us, that You know us, that You care for us, that You love us. May we be encouraged by that today as we leave this place. Whatever it is we're struggling with, may we give it over to You in this time. Maybe right there in our pew, maybe come down here at the altar and just bow before You and say, God, here it is. I need Your help. I need Your care. I need to experience Your love, Your oil of healing in my life. Father, I pray for anybody that's here who doesn't know Jesus as Savior, that today they place their faith and trust in You. And although they walk to this place not being a sheep of the shepherd, they can walk out being a sheep of the shepherd. Lord, remind us what it means to be a sheep of the shepherd this week. And I pray for this time that we are obedient to what You call us to do at this time of decision. That You would be glorified by our response. We ask this in Your name, Lord. Amen. Stand with me and you sing as you respond.
Your soul and all side, place Your hand.
about it. The Lord has laid on my heart again to do. I'm hurt. For our schools. And so I really want to just lift up our staff, our teachers, our students, our parents. It's, being married to a teacher and talking to some of our teachers here, it's crazy right now. It's they had things set up this week. I know one teacher had to change things around because the state changed things. I heard about and stuff like that. It's just different. And I know a lot of jobs are different. I know things are different for a lot of people, but school starting tomorrow for our students. So here's what I feel led to do. And like I said, I've been in this room, but I just forgot when I got up there, and I apologize to the Lord that he's reminded me again. So if you work in our schools, if you're a staff, if you're a teacher, would you please stand just for a few moments? If you're a student, would you please stand? Parents of students, would you please stand? I want you to look around and be praying for this group of people. I know there's more going to be the 11 o'clock service. Pray for them this week. It's going to be an adjustment. It's going to be frustrating at times. We're going to want to pull our hair out, whether we're a parent or student or teacher or staff, whatever it is. Let's pray for them right now. Father, this group that is standing, I lift up before you and ask that you just watch over them this coming week. Not just them, but all they represent across this state, across this nation. Lord, we know things are just different because of COVID, and we're not going to get political, Lord, but we just know they're different. So, Lord, I just pray you put your hedge of protection around this group, Lord. Lord, in the days to come, this first week especially, but the weeks and months to come, that you just protect them, Father. Protect them spiritually from the attacks of the enemy. Protect them physically, Father, from exhaustion, from frustration, from even COVID, Lord. Lord, I just pray you sustain them. You, Father, the giver of life and the sustainer of life. Lord, give them the strength they need each and every day. Father, when they do want to pull their hair out, that you give them the peace that surpasses all understanding. Father, when they have had enough, they're so frustrated because things keep changing like they do with everything going on right now. Lord, that you just would strengthen them and just encourage them. Give them sweet sleep and rest at night. That they wake up each morning feeling refreshed. And they know as they go into that next day, they're not going alone. But they are your sheep. You are their shepherd. And you know them. You care for them. You love them, Father. And Lord, I pray that we will pray for them in the weeks to come. We ask this in your name. Thank you, baby. See that Pastor Cameron's going to come and share some things.
Good. Just a couple of announcements I want to share. But first, I wanted to give you an invitation that you are invited to a baby shower honoring Brittany McDonald, and it's going to be this coming Sunday, August the 23rd at 2 p.m. in the afternoon here at church. And if you can RSVP to Jocelyn at 919-698-2277, they appreciate that. And the registry is at Target and Amazon. Again, that's this coming Sunday, the 23rd at 2 o'clock. So as Pastor Dave has told us, you know, we're just thankful we're here to worship together. And the best thing we can do for each other and everybody involved is pray. So continue to pray as we go out this week. We're thankful for everybody who stands up and does things at this time, because prayer is the most important thing we can do for each other. Just moving forward, as we're progressing through the pandemic, we want your input about the next steps to take and the right time to take them for our church. And so there's a survey in the foyer about taking those next steps. And if you would, if you haven't had a chance yet, please pick one up as you go out this morning and fill it out. And you can return it to Pastor Dave or myself or a deacon just to help us look forward. We know that the Lord is with us, and we hope that sooner than later we can get back to doing some more things at church. So we want your guys' input on that and how you feel about that and what you think. And also, from now through September, we're collecting non-perishable food for the Yates Association Food Pantry. You can pick up some extra items, and you can drop them off anytime in the barrel that's in the foyer. It's a great way to minister to those who are in need in our community. And I just want to remind everybody, we pray about this go today that we know, and we're thankful for what God's doing. We know the numbers are for the very sick are starting to come down, but we still want to remind everybody just to socially distance, do what we need to do to keep each other safe, and we pray that these things will help to go keep COVID going away very quickly. And so with that, we just want to remind everybody that we're going to dismiss from the back pew and just go out the middle aisles one pew at a time. That'll help us keep social distance and go out. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. God, thank you again for your message, and thank you for what you mean to us, Lord, that you know us by name. It's amazing to think, Lord, that with all your flock, you know us individually. None of us are left behind. None of us are left out of your thoughts, Lord, because you love us that much. Lead us, Lord, and remind us of this, Lord, that we're yours and we're special. And use us, God, to glorify you in all we do. Pray these things in your precious Son's name.